Want to get this briefing by email? Here's the sign up. Good morning. Here's what you need to know. South Korea has proposed high-level talks with North Korea next week, after the North's leader, Kim Jong-un, called for negotiations to ease military tensions and to discuss his country's participation in the Winter Olympics, which will be hosted by the South next month. In his New Year's Day speech, Mr. Kim said the North was capable of striking the mainland U.S. with a nuclear missile. I have a nuclear button on the desk in my office, he said in an analysis. Our correspondents say the comments represent a canny new strategy to initiate direct talks with South Korea in the hope of driving a wedge into its seven-decade alliance with the United States. The largest demonstrations in the country since 2009 entered a sixth day today, with at least 21 killed and 450 arrested. The protesters are voicing discontent with the pace of political and economic change, even though many sanctions against Iran have been lifted. The weak economy particularly affects the young. Officially, youth unemployment is near 20%, but experts say it's closer to 40%. Iran's supreme leader, Ayatollah Ali Khomeini, blamed the country's enemies today for the protests, his first comments since the unrest started. A wave of optimism in American businesses is bringing investment in new plants, equipment, and factory upgrades that could create jobs and perhaps raise wages. Initially inspired by the Trump administration's regulatory pullback, executives are also encouraged by continued economic growth. The notion that deregulation unleashes growth is virtually impossible to find in the data, said a one-time economic advisor to former Vice President Joe Biden. What does matter is this idea that confidence matters. If their expectations about the future are positive, then it does make a difference. Millions of people in the U.S. have fallen victim to painkiller abuse, alcoholism, the rise of meth, and the revival of heroin. As a result, entrepreneurs are sweeping in. Our multi-part series examines the industry of addiction treatment, which is haphazardly regulated, poorly understood, and expanding at a rapid clip. In the first installment, we look at one of the biggest addiction treatment companies in the country, and how the death of a patient nearly brought it down. Addressing readers of The Times, A.G. Sulzberger explains his approach to the job in a period when misinformation is rising and trust in the media is declining. Read his comments here. He'll also be answering readers' questions. Submit yours. Rupert Murdoch's decision to sell most of 21st Century Fox to Disney has many wondering what the future holds for him and two sons. Our deal book columnist, Andrew Ross Sorkin, looks at the biggest deals of 2017, and the year's big winners. Fungi could play a role in improving laundry detergents and, by extension, in reducing energy use. Hoda Kotb, a longtime NBC News correspondent, will permanently replace Matt Lauer as co-anchor of Today, the network announced. U.S. markets were closed on New Year's Day. Here's a snapshot of global markets. Tips, both new and old, for a more fulfilling life. Forget willpower. Here's how to keep your resolutions. Start the new year by relaxing and centering yourself. Recipe of the day, for a meatless meal, try pan-roasted cauliflower with garlic, parsley, and rosemary. 5 law enforcement officers were shot, one fatally by a man who had barricaded himself in a Denver suburb. Peter Martins, who shaped the New York City Ballet for more than 3 decades, announced his retirement. He denied accusations of sexual harassment and of physical and verbal abuse in college football. Alabama will face Georgia in the national championship game in Atlanta on Monday. In the semifinals, the Crimson Tide defeated the Clemson Tigers in the Sugar Bowl, and the Bulldogs beat the Oklahoma Sooners at the Rose Bowl, the three most popular movies at theaters in North America in 2017. Star Wars, The Last Jedi, Beauty and the Beast and Wonder Woman were driven by female characters. That hasn't happened in at least 37 years. Our bloopers in 360WE begin the year with an ending. Our final daily 360 video. We've made 435 videos in 426 days. Here are some of the moments that didn't make the cut in memoriam. Sue Grafton, a best-selling mystery writer, was primarily known for her so-called alphabet novels, starting with A is for Alibi in 1982 and ending in August with Y is for Yesterday. She was 77. Recky Taylor was abducted and raped by six white men in Alabama in 1944, a crime that became an early catalyst for the civil rights movement. The case never went to trial, but renewed attention decades later prompted an apology in 2011 to Mrs. Taylor by the Alabama legislature. She was 97. Quotation of the day: if you want to catch a cat, you have to stay up all night. That's just the name of the game. Jennifer Petrusca, a resident of Santa Rosa, California, and a self-described insomniac, who spends her nights tracking and trapping pet cats who went into hiding during recent wildfires. We begin today on a high kick. The Rockets closed their annual holiday season run on Monday, their 85th year at Radio City Music Hall in New York. But their famous kick lines are only a part of the storied history of one of New York's cultural cornerstones. Opened on December 27, 1932, Radio City was the largest temple of entertainment of its kind in the world, The Times, somewhat breathlessly, proclaimed. It was part of John D. Rockefeller Jr.'s plan to revive New York during the Great Depression, by building a city within a city that would provide jobs for New Yorkers and convert a neighborhood known as the Speakeasy Belt into a commercial hub. Rockefeller teamed up with the Radio Corporation of America to develop the 6,200-seat theater, and the building's design became a beacon of the Art Deco form. The theater has hosted events like the MTV Video Music Awards and more than 700 movie premieres, including To Kill a Mockingbird, starring Gregory Peck, a former Radio City usher. Mayor-elect John O'Brien declared the music hall the greatest achievement of the theatrical world, marking a new era in the history of New York. Remy Tooman contributed reporting. Your morning briefing is published weekdays at 6 a.m. Eastern and updated all morning. Browse past briefings here. If photographs appear out of order, please download the updated New York Times app from iTunes or Google Play. What would you like to see here? Contact us at briefing@newyorktimes.com. You can get the briefing delivered to your inbox Sunday through Friday. We have four global editions, timed for the Americas, Europe, Asia, and Australia, and an evening briefing on weeknights. Check out our full range of free newsletters here.